Hello everyone, today we will start the new topic, Normal Flora of Human Body. I am Dr. Sharad Deshmukh from SS Jaiswal College, Arjuni Moore. Today we will see the normal flora. So let us see what is the normal flora of the human body. So normal flora is the population of microorganisms that inhabit the skin and the mucous membranes of normal healthy person. So the microorganisms which are present constantly in the skin and the mucous membranes of the normal healthy individual is referred as the normal flora, or it may be defined in the other way, that is the microorganisms that are frequently found on or within the body of the healthy person. That is the most important thing, on or body of the healthy person. That is the most important concept, that is the organism which are normally present. There are two types of the normal flora. The one is the resident flora and second is the transient flora. So let us see the definition of these two terms. What is the resident flora and the transient flora? The first one, the resident flora, this flora can be defined as the members of the flora that are constantly present in or on the body that cannot be removed permanently. These prevent the permanent colonization of the body by the other organism. So resident flora, it name itself suggests that they cannot be removed permanently and they do not allow the colonization of the other organisms. Or it may be defined as the flora which are regularly present in a given area at a given age, and when disturbed, it promptly re-establishes itself, is known as the resident flora. So the resident flora means it cannot be removed, and even though it gets removed, it can re-establish themselves, and that's why it is referred as the resident flora. While the resident flora is concerned, the best example is the E. coli in the intestine of the man, which is present normally in the intestine of the man and the animals also. That is the Escherichia coli. That is the best example of the normal flora of the intestine. Then we'll see the second term, that is the transient flora. The transient flora means the population which varies from time to time and that can remove permanently. So earlier we have seen that the resident flora that cannot be removed permanently, and here the population is varying from time to time. Here the best example we have given is the pneumococcus or the meningococcus may be found in nasopharynx of the human from time to time. It is not constantly present. It is not always found in the nasopharynx. It may present sometimes, it may get removed, and it again it may appear. That's why the population which varies from time to time, that is known as the transient flora. The name itself suggests. So in this case we'll see the role of the normal flora. So let us see first the beneficial role of the resident flora. As far as the beneficial role is concerned, the first, it prevents the colonization of the body by the pathogens. Just we have seen that the normal flora is normally present, they do not allow to colonize the pathogenic organisms in the body, so ultimately help to prevent from the infection caused by the pathogenic bacteria. Secondly, the members of the intestinal flora, they synthesize the vitamin K and some B vitamins. So it is the most useful role of the intestinal flora of the human being. They can synthesize the vitamins, and definitely it is useful for the human beings. Then they increases overall immune status of the host against the pathogen. So why we have mentioned here the immune status? Because there are the number of the pathogenic organism are present belonging to the same genera, and the genera and their species are the different. So that species which are non-pathogenic, which may be present as a normal flora, and that's why it can help to increase the immune status of the host against the pathogen. Then the bacteriocin produced by the normal flora have the harmful effect on the pathogen. So these are able to produce the bacteriocins, and these bacteriocins have the harmful effect on the pathogenic organism. For example, the colicin, which is produced by the E. coli, this colicin can act on the other pathogenic bacteria, and that can help to prevent from the infection. The next one is the endotoxins liberated by them may help the defense mechanism of the body. The normal flora which is present, they can liberate the endotoxins, and that will help the defense mechanism of the human body. Now let us see the disadvantages or harmful character, that is the role in the disease production. So in this case, the flora becomes pathogenic when the host resistance is lowered. Although the normal flora is present, it is beneficial to us, but when the resistance power of the host is lower, they may become the pathogenic and cause the infection. Secondly, the abnormal multiplication can cause the disease, such as the enteritis and endotoxic shock. So they, if they are present, should be present in the appropriate number. If they grow abnormally, they multiply abnormally, they can cause the disease in the human beings. Then the some normal flora like Streptococcus mutans, they may cause the dental caries. They are responsible for the dental caries, that is Streptococcus mutans. That is one of the disadvantage of the normal flora. Then the isolation of the normal flora may cause the confusion in the diagnosis, because this normal flora which is present at any part of the body, that may cause the confusion in the diagnosis, because they also get isolated when you collect the clinical specimen along with the pathogenic bacteria, and you may confuse in the diagnosis the which pathogen we have isolated, whether it is normal flora or the pathogenic one. The next one is the penicillinase producing organisms can aggravate the infection by interference with the therapy. So there are some organisms which are able to produce the penicillinase, which is destroying the antibiotic, so that that organism can aggravate, they will increase in number, and ultimately the will interfere with the therapy. Then they may act as a pathogens in tissue outside their normal habitat. This is the most important characteristic. Although they are present at a particular site, for example E. coli, which is present in the intestine, it is normally present, it do not cause any harm. But if E. coli get entered into the urinary tract, then they cause the urinary tract infection. As such, the E. coli is the one of the major pathogen causing the UTI, because here they are present in the urinary tract, but if they are present in the intestine, then they are not cause any harm to the human being. Then use of the broad spectrum antibiotics affect the normal flora by inhibiting the sensitive bacteria and allow the overgrowth of the resistant bacteria. So the use of the broad spectrum antibiotics can act on the normal flora, and that will get killed, and due to the killing effect on the normal flora, that will allow the overgrowth of the drug resistant bacteria, and ultimately it is harmful to the human being. So this was about the harmful character. Now let us see today the normal flora of the skin. So as far as the skin is concerned, the skin contains 10 to the power 2 to 10 to the power 4 organism per square centimeter. So skin is the outermost covering in the human body, and each square centimeter will carry 10 to the power 2 to 10 to the power 4 organism. Secondly, the bathing has a little effect on the residental flora. So this residental flora, we are already mentioned, is constantly present, and even the bathing is done, it cannot be removed so easily. And although it gets removed, it can reappear, we have already seen in earlier characters. But the low pH, sebaceous secretions, that is fatty acids, and the lysozyme, which eliminates the non-residental microorganism from the skin. The non-residual organisms that are present, they can be removed by these low pH sebaceous secretions and the lysozyme, and that eliminate the non-resident organism from the skin. So as far as the skin is concerned, the most important species which are normally present, that include the Staphylococcus epidermidis and diptheroids, which are the most constantly present on the skin, while the other includes the Peptococcus, Streptococcus viridans, Enterococcus, Micrococcus, sometimes E. coli, Proteus, Candida, Propionibacterium, acne. These are the other organisms which are normally found on the skin. But among these, you must remember about the Staphylococcus epidermidis and diptheroids, which are the most constantly present on the skin. Secondly, the penicillin-resistant staphylococci are seen in the hospital staff. And this is because in the hospital, they are using the number of antibiotics and organisms are acquiring the resistance to the drugs. That's why these penicillin-resistant staphylococcus species are seen in the hospital staff, that is on the skin of the hospital staff. Here we'll stop here for the normal flora of the skin. We'll see the next part in the next lecture.